I enjoyed it. This business. And I appreciate y'all coming out, ladies and gentlemen. You don't kill Rusty, I always kill the cat.
Hey, everybody out there in podcast land. I'm Chuck Bryant, and that's Josh Clark.
Hi.
And we do the Stuff You Should Know podcast to the tune of about 800 episodes.
Yeah, we take topics from magnets to disco to Pez dispensers to space elevators, and we crack them open to see how they work, and then we explain it to you.
Yeah, and you're going to laugh and learn along the way. We like to call it edutainment.
Plus, there's like an indefinite risk-free trial because they're free, and they come out twice a week, so go ahead and get hooked.
We'll be right back. Is Aiden here?
On your left.
Just checking. We got the sound on.
I don't expect my cancer to come back. It's a new chapter in my life. I guess there is a sense of being a child, being a teen again. So there are times when I do feel free. I don't think I could ever fully go back to what it was like before. Bren was 7 years old and I was only 11, so we both were just kids, right?
I had no clue. I heard the cancer word, I was just like, what is that? Okay, maybe I'm gonna see him tomorrow. My eyes kind of started opening up and I was just like, Aiden's not gonna be here for a while. I'm only gonna see him maybe a couple times a week. It just keeps on going in my head, like, what if he was not gonna make it? What if I wasn't gonna see him at home anymore?
There were times when I was feeling really sick and out of it and tired, and there were times when it wasn't always the chemo, it was about how other patients in the hospital were doing.
You don't know what it's like, because I've been through so much pain, but I won't be here for 2 weeks. They'd be here for 6 months, you say?
And I was sad that there were other patients and there were other children that were younger than me going through cancers that were harder than mine. Basically, from that point on, I was like, why don't I try to get through it and then hopefully come back, help out. That's what I've basically been trying to do since I finished treatment. I got to join this club at the hospital called the Oncology Teen Group Club. It's something that you can't find out of the hospital. As a survivor, I'm still part of the teen group. There's still a lot of support that I can give to them and they can give to me, because there's an understanding that treatment isn't over when you're a survivor. There's still an emotional side of things. You have friends that are going through it, friends that aren't gonna make it through it, and that becomes a reality for you. It's not just over. Brooke was a friend of mine that I met in the hospital, and she became basically a sister to me. Brooke was definitely the closest friend that I had that I lost. The day before she passed away, I did get to see her in the hospital, and I did get to hold her hand, talk to her, and say goodbye, and tell her I loved her one last time, and I don't believe that you can accept something like that. You have to, I guess, learn to cope with it more. Before, I felt like cancer was something that was rare, that one in a ton of kids would be diagnosed, but it's not rare, and there's a lot of kids in oncology, children that are going through what you went through, and pain that is unexplainable. I want to be able to give back to those that have helped me in the hospital, that have made it so that I can go out there and be active and just live my life again.
It's a really good feeling that I could just go home and do something with my brother now. Without Children's Hospital, my brother wouldn't be here, so I'm eternally grateful for them being there.
I'm looking forward to staying connected to the hospital because it's been such a big part. Giving back and pursuing the dreams that I have and being able to do that because of BC Children's Hospital.
So I'm sure there's not a dry eye in the house. We work in a center for blood research, and it's always good for us to remember who's on the receiving end, ultimately, of all of our research efforts and what we're trying to do as scientists and researchers. And we're really lucky today to be able to meet in person this really remarkable young man, Aiden Chin, who I'm going to turn the microphone over to in a moment here, and let Aiden be able to talk to us a little bit about anything more that he would like to tell us than what was already in the video. But you can see that Aiden is a very active, engaged person in his community. He's a 17-year-old student at Templeton High School in Vancouver, and he has the experience of being a survivor of acute lymphoblastic leukemia. And I'm going to let Aiden come up here and tell you whatever he feels like telling you today.
Thank you. All right, I guess I should start from the beginning. So my journey with acute lymphoblastic leukemia, childhood blood cancer, started February 16th of 2011, and I was only 11 years old. The days before I was diagnosed, I was playing Just Dance with my cousins, I was being active, playing with my brother, and I was that average 11-year-old kid that just had a lot of energy. A few days before I was diagnosed, I started to feel really tired, really sick, and I thought, okay, maybe I just have a small cold or flu. And I ended up going to sleep and waking up the next morning feeling like, okay, I'm good, I'm feeling all right. And by the time I had gotten out of my bed, I felt like I had gone from 100 to zero in just a split second. And I was like, okay, something's not too great here. I ended up going to school a couple days later, and all my friends were saying that I looked really pale and green, and I felt really nauseous, and they said, you should probably go home. And I remember I called my family, and I was like, I want to go see the doctor. And growing up, I was always so afraid of needles, so afraid of a doctor and that kind of stuff. And so for their child that's 11 years old to tell their parents, hey, mom, dad, I want to go see the doctor, I'm really not feeling well, was kind of like a red sign for my parents. When I was told by my doctor that I was diagnosed, he asked me if I had any questions. And my first two questions were, is there a cure? And all right, let's get through this. That's how I looked at it from the very beginning. He said that it would be a roller coaster of a journey, and I've held on to that phrase ever since the beginning because that's exactly how it was. There were ups, there were downs, but in the end, the ride does hopefully come to an end. In the beginning, I had a few months of intensive treatment, which meant that I was staying at the hospital overnight for weeks, and then it went from there to about going to the hospital for about 5 hours, 5 days a week. And then during the summer, I went for high dose methotrexate, which was this huge 2-liter bag of this yellow chemotherapy that I would have to get pumped through me. And then I have to go to the washroom every 2 hours to get it out of me because it would have to go in, it'd have to kill off as much cancer cells as it could, and then it had to get out of me because it was so strong. I had radiation done to my brain because if my cancer were to come back, it would come back in my brain. So I had cranial radiation, which to do that, they had to take this layer of plastic and dip it in this really warm water and stretch across my face. And after a few seconds, it hardened. And then I had to go in every other day for about 2 weeks. And they would take this mask and bolt it down to this table and then leave me in this room. And then this radiation would happen. And it was only about 30 seconds. And it would smell like a little bit like eggs. It was kind of stinky. And it wasn't that bad, but it was. We did it because we didn't want for the cancer to come back. Through the intensive months of treatment, I had about 12 blood transfusions consisting of red blood cells, platelets, and plasma cells. So that's the whole mix of it. And 12 transfusions isn't that many compared to, I know a lot of other friends that have had over 50, over 100 different transfusions because they need it. And it helps us so much because it gives us this energy and helps us feel a lot more healthier so that we can get through the treatment and get the treatment that we need to get through it. Through the years, I attended a teen oncology group, which I still attend as a teenager. And in this group, we're able to meet other teens that have been going through treatment, are finished treatment, and are behind us, I guess, in treatment. And one of my close friends, he was a year behind me in treatment, and I remember that he was talking to me about radiation, and he was a bit nervous about it. And I remember before I had got radiation, they had given me this really old cheesy video about what it was like, and it was really not how it was. So I was able to explain to him firsthand what it was like, so he was able to hear from a friend exactly what it was going to be like, so when he went in, he knew what he was going to go through, and it would be a lot easier on him. So I've made a lot of friends throughout the times, but the thing that I feel like isn't touched upon that much as a cancer patient, as a teen, as a youth, is that if you get through treatment, that doesn't mean it's the same for everyone else. And I have had a handful of friends that aren't with me today that were very close to me, and I want to share a few of their names. Ashley, Lindsay, Kieran, and Brooke. And these friends I carry with me every day, and I do what I want to do. I do this, sharing my story, to carry on what they went through and try to spread the awareness so that others can understand what we go through and what we've had to go through. I finished treatment June 28th of 2014, and since then I've been trying to get back to normal health, being more active. I lost a lot of weight during treatment, so it took about 4 years to even get past what I had lost. I remember when I was first diagnosed at 11 years old, I was only about 50 pounds. So I've had to try to gain that back because I didn't eat for 2 weeks in the beginning. As a patient that has finished treatment, I had a lot of friends and family say, oh, so you're a survivor, you're done treatment now. And I don't particularly like that word, that, I guess, label, because when I hear the word survivor, I think, oh, done, it's over. But it's not particularly over because I'm still involved with the hospital. I still have friends that are going through it, and I feel like I'm still in it with them. And so I continue the journey, and I believe that I'm still surviving with them. Thank you.
Aiden, thank you very much for your presentation. It just really touched me. I work for Canadian Blood Services, and one question I've always wanted to ask someone who's been transfused, what does it feel like to be transfused?
Well, I guess, so before you get your transfusion, it's usually when you're really not doing well, your energy's really low. You basically just feel like laying around and not doing anything. And after a blood transfusion, it's like a boost of energy, and it just helps us be able to smile and laugh and go back to playing and living and being full and ready and healthy again.
Did you feel energy right away, or did it take a couple of hours to start feeling better after it was finished?
I'd say it was quite instant. Like once the transfusion finished, you'd feel it right away, and it would be like an instant boost to how you're feeling.
So I'm sure that Dr. Sheffield is sitting there very nervous, wondering what I'm going to say when I introduce him. But I'll behave myself, Bill, I promise. Dr. Sheffield is many things, amongst which he's a professor of pathology and molecular medicine at McMaster. He's also our associate director for research at Canadian Blood Services. Bill has a long history with the blood system, which dates back to days when he and I were both much younger. And we've asked him to close our meeting with our final presentation today by talking to us about something we've heard not a whole lot about today, which is more about the use of controlling bleeding with plasma factors, and Bill's focus is in animal models. So I'm going to ask Bill to come up and tell us all about it.
Thank you, Dana. So, being a trained observer, I noticed several things. One was, I was the last speaker, or as many last speakers say, the only thing standing between you and the refreshments. I noticed I came after a brave young man who told us about his journey, surviving cancer. And I wondered how I was going to approach it, and I decided I'd look at my slides and see what came into my head and then into my mouth, and that's what we're going to do. So, what I would like to talk to you about today, I'll talk a little bit about the origins of plasma transfusion, what I can see of as the evidence base. Some people might not agree. I will claim I'm just a poor, humble biochemist and not a clinical trialist, so don't hate me. We'll look through some animal models to investigate bleeding, to investigate the relationship between transfusing plasma and controlling bleeding. In the letter of invitation or the email of invitation that I got to come and speak to you, it was something about talking about animal models. So I felt duty-bound to talk about other people's animal models, but I will do my best to minimize their contributions and to talk more about what I've done because that's what I'd like to do. Speaking of what I've done, we have something called we call the BECCA mouse model. After reading other people's clinical trials for many years, I realized that what you really need is a great acronym. And I didn't have any acronyms. So I thought about calling our model the blood exchange coagulopathy approach, or BECCA. And as soon as I started calling it BECCA, I felt better about the work. It got funded, it got published, so BECCA. I will share with you some of our unpublished data in which we've started thinking that plasma is a relatively dilute biological fluid, and maybe we could use more concentrated sources of some coagulation factors. And we've done some work with two of the factor concentrates which are distributed by Canadian Blood Services, more on the prothrombin complex concentrate than on the fibrinogen concentrate. And I'll talk a little bit about those other models, but again, I will attempt to dissuade you from being too interested in that stuff. Okay, so I have some models of Dr. Bethune. I don't think Dr. Hess is still with us, so with reference to his previous characterization of Dr. Bethune, see, I started out, I was going to say I was honored to be speaking at the Norman Bethune Symposium, and then Dr. Hess told us all that dirt about Norman. So, at any rate, here we see Dr. Norman Bethune in China in 1938, making a contribution medically and perhaps politically to the unfortunate, the terrible situation that is a war. And on the right-hand side, you can see a picture of, before long, the war which had already come to Asia spread throughout the world. This is the Second World War. And you can see on the right-hand side of the panel, right-hand side of the slide, over there, this is a picture from someone's national archives about a wounded soldier receiving a field plasma transfusion in Italy. And the reason I show this is both to link plasma transfusion to Dr. Bethune and also to point out that it is a well-established medical procedure. It's been around for a long time. But it seems to have reversed the natural order of things if we think that what happens in the pharmaceutical industry is the natural order of things. Because there, in vitro results lead to preclinical work in animals, which then lead to clinical trials and clinical implementation of the findings. But as far as I can see, perhaps because of the immediacy of war and the great need, plasma transfusion entered into medical practice without a lot of those other things. Now, in fairness, there are significant immunological barriers to, let's say, testing human plasma in animal model systems, but nevertheless, I think some of this history resonates today. So what clinical evidence supports the value of plasma transfusion? Previous speakers touched on this peripherally, but more in the setting of trauma, where multiple blood products are being given to people who are grievously injured. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to throw Simon Stanworth and colleagues under the bus. So Simon and his colleagues have taken a very evidence-based look at this, and they say that there's no level one randomized clinical trial evidence that plasma transfusion is effective in reducing bleeding, or for that matter, in any other of its clinical indications, with the exception of plasma exchange and TTP. And to support their summary, their somewhat bleak summary of what you might call this evidentiary desert, they point out that 80 randomized controlled trials have failed to find evidence of any benefit. Nevertheless, we've seen that many physicians are convinced that plasma transfusion can be life-saving. There's huge amounts of anecdotal evidence. There's clinical trials that are in progress. There are controversial results in the recent clinical trial area. So we looked at all this and we thought, well, what contribution can we make? Because it sure sounds biologically plausible, because plasma contains all of the soluble coagulation factors. If you're bleeding, you have coagulopathy, your blood can't clot, and it seems like a reasonable thing to do to give that back. So, since I'm a molecular biologist who found that he had to use animal models to test some of the really cool proteins that he got to make in the lab, I started to think of animal models. And if you survey the literature, essentially what your task is you want to make an animal coagulopathic. You want to give them a tendency towards bleeding. And how could you do that? You can do this by hemodilution, by rapidly giving them things that are not blood in their circulation and diluting out the normal components. You can do it by trauma, and of course, if you're working in the trauma setting, you are modeling a critical medical problem that is clearly life-threatening, but it is a very complex situation in which to experiment. You can induce coagulopathy via genetic deficiency, and that's where I was first introduced to this area in terms of mice that were deficient in coagulation factor 9, so they are models for hemophilia B. Or you can do it via exchange transfusion. You can take away, you can take perfectly good blood from the animal and replace it with something else. So animal models of coagulopathy. They are dominated by swine, and I'm not talking about the researchers here, and by complexity. For reasons I don't understand, pigs in the literature are known as swine. I think this is a specialized term. I don't quite get it, but they are, to those of us who work with smaller mammals, just they're pigs. Anyway, so the trauma models are dominated by pigs, probably because it's a larger animal, because there's a lot of surgical interventions going on, and these are very complex models. So when Frith surveyed the literature a few years ago, he found 43 studies in terms of animal models of trauma-induced coagulopathy. Hemodilution was employed, traumatic injury, uncontrolled hemorrhage. At that point, couldn't find any where plasma had been used as a treatment. More recently, others have used this, this model. It's a very complex model, and it mimics a complex situation. So for instance, Imamidol, in a paper in the journal Neurotrauma, in their variation on this pig model, anesthetized animals, of course, or it wouldn't get by animal research ethics, the ribs were broken, the liver and brain was damaged, a controlled hemorrhage was employed to reduce the blood volume. Then they were left in shock for a number of hours, simulating these very complex clinical situations, and then they were resuscitated with FFP or saline. And after all that, it was found that the brain lesion, because this was a neurological model, was smaller with FFP. And there are other models where people combined elements. So they took, in one instance, they took FFP and they used it as the hemodilution agent. So they took a lot of human FFP and diluted the blood volume of the pig or the swine, depending on what you'd like to call them. And as I mentioned, existing mouse models, we found they were dominated by knockouts, and that really didn't help us, because we were trying to ask the question, does plasma transfusion relate to bleeding tendency? And if so, what components within the plasma are important? And eventually we got to, and if that's the case, then what can we replace the plasma with? So we came up with BECCA. I've already told you about how fond I am of the acronym, so I won't bore you with that again. What is BECCA? So it's we use blood exchange. We do four cycles of removing half a mil of blood, of whole blood, which is a significant volume in an animal this small. They're only about 25 grams. And we take out whole blood. We replace it with washed red blood cells in a human albumin solution, so a colloidal solution intended on mimicking plasma, which has no coagulation activity. You may wonder why we do this and why we didn't do something simpler, like simple hemodilution or replacement with without red blood cells. And the simple answer is, as we were developing the model, every time we tried to do these more aggressive things, the mice didn't make it. So we worked with what was feasible. So at the end, we came up with this model whereby, yes, there was some anemia. Red blood cells were down twofold. There was some thrombocytopenia. Platelets were down threefold. And all the plasma proteins had been reduced by a factor of five. So there was approximately 20% of all of the plasma proteins, 20% albumin, 20% factor nine, 20% fibrinogen. This increased the prothrombin time, so we had laboratory evidence of coagulopathy. The prothrombin time is similar to the INR, and we found that compared to non-exchanged animals, when we transected the tail on these anesthetized animals, there was a significant increase in the amount of blood lost. So from the point of view of the reductionist objectives we'd set ourselves, we'd set up a situation whereby we had created a coagulopathy and a bleeding diathesis. So next we asked whether this responded to plasma. So we gave a dose that was in the clinical range. We give 0.3 mils, which is 12 mils per kilogram, which is in the 10 to 15 mils per kilogram clinical range for transfusible plasma. We found, as many of you who work with animal models will well know, that there's a certain amount of variability, and we found that in order to work with this, we had to use groups of at least 15 mice. Otherwise, the innate variability became too much to see any effect. So what we saw was when we transfused the animals with wild-type plasma at that level, we could significantly reduce the amount of blood loss. And having set up the situation, we could ask questions about what was important in the plasma. And so if we look in Canada at what our regulators tell us is important about plasma quality, we find out that there's only one marker, and it's coagulation factor 8. But many people have suggested that's not a particularly good marker for what plasma is transfused for its indications. And in our model, we found that if we used plasma from factor 8 knockout mice, containing no factor 8 whatsoever, this worked just as well. On the other hand, if we substituted plasma from fibrinogen knockout mice, that plasma was ineffective. So we felt that we'd started to make, we had something that was somewhat useful. People have said this is not a trauma model. That's true. It's not intended to be a trauma model. Remember, I'm a poor, humble country biochemist. If only I had a shot of Star Trek where I could be the doctor and I could be telling, I guess this would make you Jim, Dana. It's a good thing I don't have a slide of Star Trek. It's a very good thing because, you're certainly not Lieutenant Uhura, so we're just going to leave it at that. So no Star Trek slide, and back to being a poor, humble country biochemist. We tried to keep these variables change as few variables as possible. So these animals are not hypovolemic. They have a normal blood volume. This is a situation where we asked for simple things, and we got simple things, and we can ask relatively simple questions. Many people have also criticized the tail model injury. They have pointed out the anatomically 100% correct point that most humans do not have tails. And those who are somewhat deeper thinkers point out that in transecting the tail, you cut two veins and an artery. So we thought, okay, we need an independent way of assessing whether we've done what we think we've done to hemostasis in vivo. And what we used here was a laser injury model whereby an injury was made in the intact microvasculature. This was done in Heyu Ni's lab, one of my co-investigators. And in this situation, so we recreated the Becca model, and he told me he didn't think the animals would survive both that manipulation and this manipulation, but they did. And we were able to determine that, so here we were asking about the ability of the system to form a thrombus. So it's an intact vasculature. It's another readout for coagulation. And indeed, we found results which mirrored what we'd seen with the tail clip. So here we see the size of the thrombus, which is imaged using fluorescent platelets. increased by transfusion of wild-type plasma. Fibrinogen knockout plasma was ineffective, and factor VIII knockout plasma was as effective as wild-type, as we'd seen in the other model. So this encouraged us, because it seemed like from two completely different models, we were coming to a similar endpoint. There are other things we can do with this system. So I naively suggested that we would have no difficulty in absorbing out the natural antibodies which make very difficult xenotransfusion. I was wrong, and I won't talk about that anymore. I did have a workaround, which was to take purified human plasma proteins and reconstitute plasma. And we're getting somewhere with that, but it's pretty messy, and the effect versus the background is not large. What I will tell you about in the time remaining is how we've used this model and expanded the model into an additional hemostatic challenge involving transection of the liver in order to ask whether we could get the same effect that we'd seen with plasma with factor concentrates, PCCs and fibrinogen. So PCCs are, probably many people in this audience know what they are. They're products of plasma fractionation. I've encountered people who think that the plasma fractionators have six enormous vats, and they have people who go and they scoop lyophilized proteins from one vat to another, and then they combine them. And the vats are labeled prothrombin, factor 7, factor 9, factor 10, protein C, and protein S. And that's not the way plasma fractionation works. Instead, these products are enriched in those proteins. They have a background of all the other plasma proteins at very, very low levels. So these products are recommended for urgent reversal of warfarin. So if patients are on oral anticoagulation and their physicians need to urgently reverse them, perhaps because of surgery, perhaps because they're bleeding, and they're concentrated about 25-fold over the levels of those factors in plasma. We turned to our model, and we said, okay, let's see how PCCs work. And we'd done some previous work in this area that was a lot easier. There, we'd given mice doses of warfarin, or we'd given them dabigatran and texalate, oral anticoagulants, and we'd sought to reverse those effects. And what we found there was similar to what people see in the preclinical and then in clinical practice, that PCCs are effective in that manner. But here we were asking if they were more of a general hemostatic agent. And we found we could get an equivalent effect to plasma at a dose which corresponds to one of the doses recommended for warfarin reversal. I think the doses have changed a little bit over time, but this was the one that was recommended by the National Advisory Committee in 2008. And we did a dose response, titrating downwards, and we found pleasingly that there was indeed a dose response. Yesterday, I was dropping by posters, much like it's done here, but for students at McMaster University who've done biochemistry 3R06, and I saw someone who'd started to do a titration curve, but there was no, like, they went from 2 micromolar of their agent down to 100 nanomolar, and there was no difference. I said, you ever think you might have a buffer effect? Because when we do a dose response, we like to see a difference. And I think I scared the young person, so I won't talk about that anymore. So our next question, as an extension of that idea about the pharmaceutical industry or the plasma fractionation industry having big vats, they don't have the big vats, but we have access to purified prothrombin, factor 7, factor 9, and factor 10. And so we were asking the question, now, you're all going to say, of course, that you already know the answer. The answer is the anti-hemorrhagic effect, the question, sorry, not the answer. The question is the anti-hemorrhagic effect of PCC due to its vitamin K-dependent coagulation factors? And you're all saying, duh, of course it is. But in experimental science, we need to demonstrate these things. And I had a reason for doing that, because I thought if we could show that, then we could do more reductionism, and we could ask if all of the components are required. So we went ahead and did that, and we found indeed that combinations of those four factors, without any protein C or protein S, we did the titration curve or the dose response, and we found that we could find a combination of what we called modified PCC that was just as effective as plasma or just as effective as the commercial PCCs in reducing bleeding. And we said, that's kind of interesting. What happens if we only use three factors? And the answer was that we could omit any one of the four factors in turn unless we left out prothrombin. And if we left out prothrombin, the mixture was not that effective. I thought, that's kind of interesting. I wonder if that points to the fact that maybe prothrombin is one of the key factors in plasma. And we continue to pursue that concept. So we thought it would be nice to show another. So we're still in the Becca model. We've still got blood exchange mice, but we added a different hemostatic challenge, which we found in the literature, which involves the transection of the liver, the surgically exposed liver, and the simple expedient or readout of capturing the shed blood into a teared weighboat, which you can then weigh at the end of the observation period. So it's a very simple model, and we were encouraged to find that we saw the same hierarchy of results. So first of all, we did it in normal mice because people told me that Becca mice couldn't survive liver transection, but they were actually wrong, or at least for the 15-minute period of observation. I make no claims about what would happen to the mice after that. But it is actually doable. We first did experiments in normal mice where we showed that we could get an effect with PCC, and we could similarly get an anti-hemorrhagic effect with our homemade factors, unless we lacked prothrombin, in which case it doesn't work. And we saw the same pattern of results with Becca mice. So what about fibrinogen? And since I'm a believer in human rights, I didn't show you the coagulation cascade. And I thought about not doing it at all, given the lateness of the hour and all the learning and stuff that you've done all day long. But then I couldn't help myself. So essentially, fibrinogen's down here, and the various procoagulant factors, the four vitamin K-dependent procoagulant factors, are up here. And essentially, we thought, well, if we can drive the system forward with some of these factors, then why not the one that's right down at the business end, just before the formation of fibrin? So we've done a little bit of work with fibrinogen in the Becca model. We found that it's very hard to get a response to fibrinogen. We have to go to very high doses. So I would say it grudgingly responds to quite high doses of fibrinogen. So perhaps that tells us something about the sensitivity of the system to fibrinogen, and perhaps there's some clinical parallels, as was mentioned by some of the earlier speakers. And we're thinking, well, we've proposed in a funding application that we will continue to investigate this in terms of PCCs and fibrinogen. There are, for reasons that escape me, this is the standard of care for trauma patients in Austria. And since I'm not a trialist, I will say no more. But we thought that perhaps we should investigate this experimentally, where we have control of all the variables. Yes. One of the reviewers of my previous grant application, or my current grant application, said something about, I have no doubt that Dr. Sheffield will learn a lot about transfusion in the mouse. Or mouse training. Anyway, the clear implication was it was only good for mice and had nothing to do with humans. So, for unexplained reasons, I got funded, so we continue with the experimental plan. But this kind of weighed on me, and I thought about the fact that I often, in my administrative role at CBS, I say to people, so what's your translational path? So I looked myself in the mirror and I said, what's your translational path? And I tried this stuff about I'm a poor, humble country biochemist, and it didn't work. So I thought we should actually do some work in a human system, and of course we'll start in vitro. We can't go further in vitro without clinical partners. So let's start in vitro. So what we did was to try to mimic what we'd done to the mice. So we diluted human normal pool plasma to 20% reaction volume. We made some other adjustments to take into account the anticoagulants. And then we said, okay, we had an animal with a blood volume of about a mil that we added in 300 microliters of treatment fluid. So what would that look like? And so that's what we compared. So we did these diluted PTTs, and in the lower panel, first of all, fortunately, human plasma is more sensitive to this kind of dilution in this assay than is mouse, so that was fortunate. And what we found, again, was this was the same kind of pattern. We could reduce the PT, or we could promote coagulation. We have more rapid coagulation if we use PCC or if we use the four-factor homemade modified PCC. But we couldn't get quite the same effect if we were using three-factor. And we tried this also in thrombin generation assays, making the same assumptions. So we dilute, we set up our reaction volume, and then we hit it with the with tissue factor, calcium, and the fluorogenic substrate, and we found the same thing. So essentially, although the shape of the curve is different, this is what happens when we put in our four-factor. This is what happens when we put in PCCs. The area under the curve is similar. You get a different shape and you get more thrombin generation, probably because you haven't introduced the anticoagulant factors here that you have here. But what I was more interested in was that when we use saline as the simulated treatment fluid, or we use the three-factor concentrate lacking prothrombin, we get the same effect. So you have to look at this a little bit sideways, or be an optimist, or a combination of both, but I think we have some data that suggests there may be something to what we see in the mouse in the human system. And we're going to try and continue to look at what happens in vivo in our model, and what happens in vitro with different tests, including Rotem. So what have other people seen? There's a larger literature in terms of PCC administration in other animal models. And what was found can be summarized is that it's heterogeneous. And it's not terribly surprising because the doses and the timing of intervention are different among these different models. So PCC administration reduced blood loss after liver or bone injury, but not spleen injury in the pig. There's a couple of studies out on that, some of which come from industry. I asked one of my colleagues to do a literature review for a corporate purpose at Canadian Blood Services in the last couple of months. And he came back with something that was really focused on whether a company sponsored or it was not company sponsored. And I thanked him and told him I didn't realize he was a bomb-throwing anarchist and that I generally looked more at the controls than the sponsorship. But at any rate, some of these studies come from companies because they fit into the preclinical to clinical spectrum of normal development. There's some work in rabbits. It's a mixed bag, so we're not quite sure how to interpret that. So what does all this mean? So as I have said at length, and some of you might say ad nauseum, I started out as a biochemist, it kind of looks like mass action. I mean, if you provide more factor, if you're in a first order reaction, so A, there's some kind of change, and you get B. So we know that the reaction velocity is proportional to the input. So that if you think of the reactions of fibrinogen leading to fibrin, and you provide more starting material, perhaps that's what's going on. Now, there's an awful lot of complexities in coagulation. There's cellular interactions, there's surfaces, there's all kinds of things going on. But I think our data and other people's data suggest that you don't necessarily need all the coagulation factors in the setting that we have deliberately engineered. And you have to think about that, because the mice have 20% residual coagulation. We tried to drive them down lower. Bad things happened. So we're looking at a setting where the in vivo, where the host is definitely coagulopathic, but they're not devoid of coagulation factors. And you have to keep that in mind. I think one of the examples that Dr. Hess showed, that unfortunate soldier who'd had half his or her, I couldn't tell from the picture, leg chomped off. In that setting, there's probably very little left. They're probably almost certainly down below 20%, maybe 10%, maybe 5%, not sure. We could not drive our model down to those depths. So I've had a lot of fun telling you about our research and casting aspersions on other people's research. Not really. I don't That was just to try and enliven you, because I don't know about you, but I felt that some of the air went out of the room at different times this afternoon for different reasons. So I tried to be a little, inject a little levity with no disrespect to any of the very serious issues that have been described. So what have I told you? What did we find? We found that either the commercial fractionation product, the PCCs, or our modified PCCs, they reduce blood loss and bleeding times. I didn't focus on bleeding times. We have dutifully measured the bleeding times hand in hand with the blood losses, because people look at different things in the literature, and because reviewers, if you only give them one, they sometimes ask for the other. In all cases, we find the bleeding times match the blood loss, except it's a discontinuous measure, so it's not quite as sensitive. We found that three-factor combinations may be equally effective as the four-factor combination. As I was writing up the manuscript, which is under review at the Journal of Thrombosis and Hemostasis for this, I came across a paper whereby a recombinant prothrombin had been used in hemophilia A and hemophilia B mice, and it was found to be effective in reducing bleeding. So maybe someone else has come across this effect that we are hoping to investigate further. We found that tail bleeding mimicked liver bleeding, and that relieved us because of the criticisms that have rightly been aimed at the tail bleeding model. And we have hope for some degree of transmissibility, or maybe some degree of translating to, if not the clinic, to the question of plasma quality of transfusible plasma as a product from our human in vitro test results. I think I have bored the person with the yellow sign into inactivity, because I haven't seen the yellow sign yet. I will discard that hypothesis since he's now smiling at me, and just close, since I seem to have lots of time, by acknowledging the many people who were involved in this work. Louise Eltringham-Smith is and Varsha Bakhtar are research assistants in my laboratory. Dr. Saeed Kadri is a postdoc who started to move the model into the liver transection area. Melissa Lamborn, a former research assistant in the laboratory who really, really likes her dog. And co-investigators, Dr. Ed Preistel and Dr. Hei Yuni, they lent their reputations and names to the funding applications that allowed us to do this work. And Zi Li, Dr. Dili Rahiman, and Dr. Yiming Wang are parts of Dr. Ni's group in Toronto. And I'm grateful for funding from the Canadian Blood Services Intramural Research Grant Program, and I'd be very happy to take any of your questions, and I salute you and commend you on remaining conscious at this point.
The boss is telling me to ask you a question.
You're in conflict of interest. I want to.
What kind of question would you like? What effect would you think that also adding platelets to your red cells in your BECA model might have?
We thought about that during model development, but it got a bit dicey. And we became aware of a paper from the Nieswand group in which they demonstrated that bleeding in mice is essentially insensitive to platelet levels until you cross the threshold of 3% of normal. So at that point, we became less concerned about platelets. I hope that answers your question. We have thought about various manipulations. We've thought about a mouse blood bank, and we've thought about, I mean, the trauma area is compelling because of the need of the patients involved. But from a scientific point of view, it's just so complicated that I have tried, as I went on about at length, to keep to a more reductionist or a simplified approach, and try and, if we had findings, we could interpret them a lot easier.
I was thinking, especially in light of Hayu's laser model, that might make a difference, maybe not in the other models. But anyhow, and I was also wondering...
Well, the sensitivity goes down. In normal mice, you have a lot more platelets, and therefore you have a lot larger signal from that thrombus. But it does work. So as one of our colleagues, Dr. Don Branch, said to me the other day, I say to hey you, booyah.
So Bill, how much blood does a 25 gram mouse have? Like 2 mils or 2
mils? It's between 6 to 8% of body weight.
So you said when you take more than half a mil out, they die.
Well, they essentially have a blood volume of around 2 mils, 1.5 to 2 mils. If we take out more than half a mil at a time and replace it with, let's say, Ringer's lactate, they don't die immediately, not on the first exchange, but we can't get to the fourth exchange without them expiring.
It's not a blood pressure issue, or do you know what?
No, I don't think so, because we haven't cannulated, so the half mil comes out,
so
and the half mil goes in.
Yeah.
And you say, oh, how clever you are, Bill. You did that in order to simplify your model. Well, in part, but I also just balked at the idea of having to measure mouse blood pressure.
What does the heart stop, or what kills them?
In the ones that don't make it, definitely yes. Yes. Okay. This is done under full anesthetic cover, and what we notice is that they exhibit labored breathing, very labored breathing, and then we wonder whether they're still alive, and then we know they're not alive, and their hearts have stopped. So yes, it is circulatory failure for sure.
I want to thank, I think everybody wants to thank everybody here for an amazing day. And we have a couple of little formal lessons. First, all those volunteers, and there were many, judges and mic runners and yellow flaggers, there are prizes or thank you cards, at least cards, that you can pick up at the registration desk from Anna if you haven't already received them. Second, to a major thank you, though, to Anna and Hannah. Huge round of applause, really. We do have an award to give for the best poster, and I've been told that it's Erica Siren. Come on. I have no idea what it is.
Oh, you don't?
No, I don't.
Thank you very much.
All right. And last but not least, Dana. So in about November time, I think it was, Dana, yes, I came in and sort of realized, the Bethune Symposium, we have to start organizing. Do you have any ideas? And she looks at me and she says, do you want me to organize it? And I said, pardon? Are you serious? Please, please, please. And she said, sure. And, you know, we can do this together. And, you know, and she's a little more linked to the transfusion community than I am. So she was certainly a prime candidate, I must say. And then we sort of sat down and sort of sketched out some ideas. And she came back to me about a week later. And, you know, we sat down. And then a week later, Zika. And all of a sudden, the world changed for many reasons, and I sort of lost track of Dana. She sort of disappeared into, well, Ottawa, Washington, I have no idea, but a lot of policy discussions, healthcare stuff, and so it was a while. It was certainly a good month, and then she had to have a recovery period. from all the stresses, and I just wondered, is Bethune going to really happen? I did ask her, you sure you really want to do this? And she says, yeah, I got it under control. And then I sort of spotted her husband down the hall, and I asked him, and he says, well, she says she's got it. So anyway, she did have it. She did an amazing job. She really, really organized this whole symposium, and I think we owe her a huge round of thanks. So with that, I'd like to thank all the speakers, of course, and all of you for coming. Wine, cheese, food, everything's out there. All right? Thank you very much.